Blackstone presents Mothers and Dogs, Stories by Fabio Morábito, translated by Curtis Bauer. This book is read by Rogelio Ramos, Thom Rivera, Gary Tiedemann, Kyla Garcia, and Marcio Catalano.
The Sailboat. The for sale sign was hanging in the window of the room he had shared with his brother. Ricaño pulled a piece of paper out of his jacket pocket so he could write down the number of the real estate agency and then took a few steps back to contemplate the five-story building where he was born. Compared to the new buildings on the street, it looked conspicuously outdated. He crossed to the other sidewalk to go into a cafe, which had been a greengrocer's when he was a kid, and walked directly to the phone. He dialed the number he had just written down, and a woman's voice answered. Ricaño said that he was interested in seeing the apartment that was for sale, and the woman gave him a brief description of the place before telling him the price. He confirmed that he wanted to see it, and the other warned him, "The tenants are still there." I mention this because some people don't like to see an apartment with people inside. Ricaño told her it was better that way, that it would give him a better idea of the space because it was furnished. The woman said she would call the tenants right away to notify them of his visit, and they made a plan to meet at the entrance to the building at 4 that afternoon. She asked his name, and he replied, "Santibáñez." After hanging up, he ordered a cup of coffee at the bar. He gave himself 20 minutes. He imagined that was enough time for the woman from the agency to call the tenants, notifying them about his visit that afternoon. He ordered a second coffee and glanced at the sports paper someone had left on a table. He looked at his watch, paid, and crossed the street. He rang the intercom doorbell, and a young girl answered. He said he was the person interested in buying the apartment. The device crackled, and a few seconds later, a woman's voice asked him who he was. "I am Señor Santibáñez, the person interested in buying the apartment," Ricaño repeated. "Weren't you supposed to come this afternoon?" "Yes, but since I'm in the area, it'd be more convenient for me to see it now, if it's not a bother." The woman told him to wait a moment, and he heard the raspy noise a hand makes covering the intercom handle. He pressed his face against the glass to look inside the building and saw that everything was still the same. A strip of linoleum crossed the lobby leading to the elevator and stairs. A few minutes passed, and he was about to ring the bell again when he saw a girl approaching from the far end of the hallway. The girl observed Ricaño through the glass and opened the main door. "Señor Santibáñez?" she asked. "That's me." She invited him in. As he followed her, he estimated that she was about 16 years old. They climbed the five steps leading to the hallway with the first floor apartments, and the teen rapped her knuckles on the door three times. He read the last name on the small placard next to the doorbell, Del Valle. A woman in her 40s opened the door. Her features left no doubt that she was the girl's mother. "Come in, excuse the mess," she said without extending her hand. "I'm the one who should apologize," Ricaño said, and standing in the entryway was enough for him to feel the traumatic certainty of having been a child within those walls. He was stunned by the sight of the lintels, the door handles, and, more than anything else, seeing the floor tiles again. He stood stock still, and the woman, seeing he was self-conscious, said, "Come this way, please." But instead of following her, he squeezed the bridge of his nose to hide his emotions. She asked if he was feeling okay. "Excuse me," Ricaño said, covering his face with his hand. At the moment, a girl maybe 4 or 5 years old appeared. "Why is the man crying, Mama?" she whispered. Ricaño looked to the side so the girl couldn't see his face, turned around, and opened the door to leave, but it was latched with a chain lock. He tried to unlatch it, and the teen came to help him, unfastened the chain, and opened the door. Ricaño walked out and stopped on the landing. "Are you feeling ill, Señor Santibáñez?" the mother of the girls asked again. He took some tissues out of his jacket pocket and dried his eyes. "Excuse me," he said. "This house brings back a lot of memories." "You've been here before?" "I lived here my whole childhood." He squeezed the bridge of his nose again and smiled weakly. "I've lived abroad for the last 40 years. Whenever I come back, I come here."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.